Getting started in SynthEdit can be fun, but challenging at times, and it can be difficult to figure out the nuances of using the program. Today, I'd like to go over 5 tips that will help make sure that your plugin development goes as smooth as possible. When you first get started developing plugins in SynthEdit, there are some common issues that you might run into that can be a roadblock to getting your plugin created. And there are some general tips I have that I think are useful for someone learning to use SynthEdit. So I'd like to talk about 5 things that I think will help your time in SynthEdit go as smoothly as possible. The first tip is to make sure that everything you create is placed inside a main container. You can consider this main container to be the entire plugin that you'll add to your DAW later. Any inputs and outputs on this container will be the actual MIDI and audio inputs and outputs on your plugin. Anything outside of this main container will work correctly in SynthEdit, but will throw an error when you try to export it. So save yourself some time and start the project inside a new main container. That leads us to the second tip for working in SynthEdit. Make sure to organize your plugin by placing sequences of modules in their own containers. Typically, you'll want to separate the plugin into components, like the oscillators on a synth, along with the modules that are working with them to create our sound waves. They can be organized down into an oscillator container, cleaning up space from your project window. Other components you should do this with are effects sections, like echo or delay, or with a section of high-pass and low-pass filters. Each of these can be sectioned off and combined into one container. When you're just starting your project, everything will be easy enough to navigate, but it won't take long before you fill your window up with modules and patch cords going all over the place. Trust me, it gets difficult to navigate where the cords are going and what they are plugged into when there are tons of other cords sitting on top of them. Start your project out by putting related modules together in their own container, and your development later on in the project will go much smoother. You'll be able to easily tell what section does what, and you'll be able to see exactly where each of the chords go. The third tip we've got for working in SynthEdit relates to how to save your plugin as an instrument or an effect. If you want to create an instrument, you'll need to make sure to have a MIDI input to your synth container. If you don't have a MIDI input, you won't have the option to save as a synth. Once you're ready to export the plugin, go to File, Export VST. From there, all you need to do is check the box Plug is Synth. If you don't have a MIDI input on your main container, the plugin will be considered an effect, and when you go to export it, the box Plug is Synth will be grayed out and won't be selectable. Once you try to export your plugin, you may have some trouble, because the default export location requires administrator permissions. What you need to do is go into Edit Preferences, and then to File Locations. From here, you can choose where you want your plugin to be exported to. I've got mine exporting to a SynthEdit folder in My Documents. When you do that, you won't have any trouble exporting your plugin. Also, after you export your plugin, there may be additional files in the folder that you've exported to, such as these files here. For your synth to properly load in the host program, you have to place these files in your VST plugin's location with the actual plugin file. It's best to place the entire folder in your VST plugin location so everything stays organized. This leads us to the fourth tip for working in SynthEdit, and that is if you're using SynthEdit 1.2's 64-bit version, you can save your plugin as a VST3 file. There are benefits to using a VST3 instead of the older VST2 format, which was saved as a .dll file. One of them is performance. Using a VST3 version of a plugin will use less CPU power than a VST2 plugin doing the exact same thing. When you're using a lot of CPU and trying to keep your latency low, this can make a world of difference. But if that was it, there would be no reason to even consider using VST2. The problem with using VST3 is not all hosts support VST3 plugins, and you won't be able to load them up. To deal with this, you can change type from VST3 to VST2 here in the settings when you choose to export VST. Doing this will forego any benefits to using the VST3 spec, of course, but will allow your plugins to load in most host programs. It's wise to offer a VST3 and VST2 version of your plugins. That way, anybody who has the capabilities to run a VST3 can do so and take advantage of the benefits. If their host software doesn't have the ability to run VST3 plugins, they can revert to the DLL VST2 version. The final tip I've got for using SynthEdit is to pay attention to the number of external, third-party modules you decide to use. Windows has a limitation that you can only load 300 DLLs at one time, which each of the external modules you use is loaded as. When considering a single plugin, 300 external modules is a lot, so you're unlikely to run into an issue. But that's with one plugin. When creating a mix, the user won't be using a single plugin. They'll be using multiple plugins, each one of them counting towards that limit. If someone were to load 10 VSTs containing 30 external modules, they would reach the limit. If they tried to load another plugin, it would fail to load. You can combat this by using native modules to accomplish what you're trying to do before looking for a third-party module. Even if it's a little more complicated to build it yourself, using the native modules is the better choice. The native modules don't count against the 300, so try to use them whenever you can. The other solution is to use SEM files that contain multiple related modules in one package. This way, they only count as one against the 300 total. Just keep track of how many SEMs that you're using, and you should be good. Remember that 10 or more plugins could be loaded in a user's project, so that limit of 300 can be approached quicker than you'd like. So there you go, 5 tips for working with SynthEdit. Let's recap all 5 of them real quick. First, make sure to keep everything inside of a main container. Second, clean up the project file and make each section's purpose easier to understand by organizing modules into their own containers. Third, if you want your plugin to be a playable instrument, make sure to include a MIDI input to the main container. Otherwise, your plugin will be considered an effect and will only load on a mixer channel. Fourth, save as both a VST3 and VST2 version so that your users can take advantage of the benefits of VST3 if their host supports them. And the fifth tip is to pay attention to the total number of external third-party modules that you include in your plugins, and try to use native modules whenever possible. I hope these 5 tips will help all of you out while you're working in SynthEdit. Some of these tips are issues that I've ran into while developing my own plugins, and hopefully they will save you some time and prevent you from dealing with the same problems.